One of the important things is to characterize the radii and masses of exoplanets. And indeed, you would like, if possible, to know something about ages as well, the age of the system. And as you know, the best techniques, the ones that have been most successful in saying anything about these quantities, are based on knowing the radii and masses of the stars around which these planets evolve. So that means that in order to get this information, we have to have accurate information about the radius of the star, the mass of the star, and if possible, also the age. In the case of transit, what you're measuring is the ratio of the planetary radius to the radius of the star, and therefore, in order to get this, you must know that. In the case of RV, likewise, you're getting a ratio. And of course, the assumption is that the age of the planetary system is the same as the age of the star. So if you had information about the age of the star, then you would have implicitly information about the age of the planet. And that's actually something that would be very valuable in trying to understand the various planets that we're seeing, because in many cases, they do significantly evolve over geologic time, especially those that have distended atmospheres over a high-density core. Now, you might have thought that the usual approach to understanding stellar structure would be good enough to tell you these things. And indeed, when I was a graduate student at Cornell, taking a class from Ed Saltpeter about stellar structure, one certainly got the impression that the physics is, for the most part, known. And that's actually true. But of course, if you want to get these things to a few percent, that's a much more challenging task than understanding the basic physics. So what is it that people usually do? What you can measure, of course, is the effect of temperature. That's straightforward enough. You can also measure the metallicity, not quite so straightforward, but that's fairly standard. What else? Well, there is a time-honored technique for getting little g, the acceleration due to gravity. And that time-honored technique, imperfect though it is based on a piece of physics that we've already talked about at the school, which is that the place from which the photons are escaping is at a pressure that is about g upon kappa, where kappa is the opacity. And pressure affects the spectral lines, so that if you are at high pressure, spectral lines get broadened. If you are at low pressure, the spectral lines are narrower. And people put a lot of effort into this, beginning back in the 20s and 30s, to understand this. And they thought they had a good enough understanding of kappa that they could get little g. And indeed, when you look at textbooks about stellar structure, they will tell you about this in great detail. And it's true, but the accuracy with which you can do that is rather weak. And so you're talking about a factor of 2 or something like that in many cases. So yes, that has played an important role. The other thing you might imagine is, of course, using this equation. And you say, okay, if I know the effect of temperature, which I do, and if I know the luminosity, then of course I can calculate the radius. The problem with doing that, of course, is that you usually don't know the distance to the star with sufficient precision. In some cases you do, but in most cases you don't. We heard already earlier this week about Hipparchus and Gaia, and there are future missions as well, where the length scale for the distribution of stars, how far stars are away, will be improved upon. And so this will start to be an important procedure for getting radii, but for the most part, this works only in a limited number of cases. You can also, if the star's large enough radius, actually use speckle, use interferometry, and so those techniques have been used as well. But it's imperfect. And of course, the other thing you can do, the time-honored thing, is models. So what do I mean by a model? I mean, in the same spirit as Tristan talked about for giant planets, you can do actually even better for stars, because the physics is actually simpler. Stars are simpler than planets, a lot simpler. At least for stars of order the mass of the Sun and less massive, but not brown dwarfs, which are starting to become degenerate, one has basically an ideal gas. One has a pretty good idea of opacity. So you can go forward and calculate the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium. You can throw in the nuclear physics, although one of the amazing things about stellar structure is that you can actually understand a lot of it without knowing the specifics of nuclear reactions. But all of that is in place, and so you can do your modeling. And so you might ask, what's wrong with that? And the answer is, it's okay, but again, it's not highly accurate. I'll give you an example of one of the major difficulties there. One of the major difficulties is characterizing the convection. For example, in the case of the Sun, you have a convective zone, radiative interior. In order to model what the temperature profile is in the convective zone, you use something called mixing length theory, simple theory of convection. And that theory tells you the extent to which the temperature gradient is in excess of the adiabat. This turns out to be an issue that is not important in giant planets because the luminosity of giant planets is small. But in stars, it's actually significant because the convective velocities become a significant fraction of the speed of sound. And so the parameterization of mixing length theory, of the convection theory, turns out to introduce a significant uncertainty. One also has to play games with the initial helium abundance. We think you understand that, but that's still in there. And of course, the crucial parameter of age. Stars on the main sequence, for example, the Sun, slowly grow over time as they develop a core that is helium-rich. We understand that. We understand all the physics. But properly parameterizing that for stars in general is difficult. So yes, this plays an important role. And it will also play an important role in what I tell you next about the method that is best. But it's not good enough by itself. So this description here of how to do things is not enough to get these numbers to better than 5 or 10%. It depends on the kind of star and an even larger uncertainty there. So what is the technique that has been most valuable? It is astroseismology. Somebody at the school asked me earlier this week, why is it astroseismology rather than astroseismology? I didn't know the answer immediately, so I looked it up. Astro means star. It is the Greek suffix for star. Astro has a related origin, but it actually means everything to do with stars, not the star itself, but the structure of the universe. Galaxies, how stars cluster, and so forth. So indeed, since we're talking about a method for understanding the interior properties of specific stars, it should be called astroseismology, not astroseismology. And of course, there's many other kinds of seismology. Helioseismology, which has been immensely valuable for understanding the structure of the Sun, and the seismology on planets. Especially the Earth, a lot of our understanding, in fact, the most important aspect of our understanding of Earth structure has come from using seismology on the Earth. Okay, so the basic principle here is to look at the star and see if you can discern by looking at the star its normal modes. And of course, this is like our bell. And you might ask, well, what are the characteristics of the sound you hear as a function of this thing? Now, this is actually fairly complicated, although it is actually symmetric. But what you're hearing is not a single frequency. It's actually a combination of tones. The primary, that is the lowest order mode, that is excited when I do this is dominating, and actually that's because the sound, the wavelength of the waves that are being emitted are long compared to this object, and when you have an object that's small compared to the wavelength, you prefer to go to the lowest frequency modes in the excitation. If I were to be holding a bell here that is substantially bigger, you know from personal experience how the sound of that changes. It becomes deeper. And of course, if I were to have a smaller bell, it would be a high tone. Hi! It's an interesting question, actually, as to whether by doing an analysis of the sound from this bell, you could actually discern the properties of the bell. In principle, assuming, of course, that you knew the material, so you have to know something about the material, right? The material properties come in. But if somebody told you, yes, it's a bell, and it's made of brass or whatever, could you, through looking at the spectrum, actually figure out the properties of this bell? I don't actually know the answer. This is a kind of complicated object. But, of course, it's certainly true for organ pipes. You all know what organ pipes are like. You know, the big organ pipes produce the bass sounds, and the little organ pipes produce the squeaky sounds, and so forth. And stars are like that, too. So stars, of course, are emitting primarily low frequencies if they're big. More precisely, if they are low density, that we'll see why that's important, and high frequencies if they're small. I should say one more thing about this, of course. When you hear the tone of this, that's not the way we do astroseismology, because you're not actually receiving the sound waves. And of course, the way that this thing produces sound waves is by the coupling of the surface to the air adjacent. If you wanted to actually see the excitation of this surface, especially the spatial structure, what you would do, right, is bounce a laser signal off it and look for the Doppler, right? And that technique is used. That's used in Fourier spectroscopy, which is something Tristan knows all about, because that is actually the technique that has been used to see the normal modes on Jupiter. Now, of course, in a star, if I've got the surface vibrating, that will also show up photometrically. So our goal for a while now is going to be to understand the basic characteristics of the kind of photometry that you get if you have long cadence records. That means records that have been collected over a substantial period of time, frequency against intensity, and I will show you slides later, but what one gets for a star is some set of normal modes which show up as resonant peaks in the fluctuation of the light. And what we want to understand is the spacing of these and the general character of this spectrum. It's the frequencies that are telling us something about the properties of the star, the information that we want to use to get radius and mass. It turns out, and I must confess, this surprised me a bit when I started reading about the subject, that people also use the envelope, that is, where it is in the frequency domain, to discern information as well. So they're actually, in a sense, also using amplitude, which I would have thought is a bit tricky, because we don't actually really understand the amplitude of this behavior. It's stochastically excited by convection in a convection zone of the star, but the details of that are not simple, and so it's not a straightforward matter to decide what information is obtained in the amplitude of these peaks in the intensity as a function of frequency. By the way, frequencies we're talking about here, you will see this, but they typically correspond to hundreds of or thousands of microhertz, in other words, millihertz, reciprocal of which, is, of course, is a time scale like, say, 1,000 seconds, but you need to collect a lot of data. I will show you later the kind of data that exists. The best data comes from Kepler. There was a mission, COROD, the European mission, which was actually more dedicated to this kind of science, but in the end, it turns out that Kepler was the most spectacular. Okay. At this point, I should say that I'm actually not an expert on astroseismology. And so I had to prepare for this talk by reading review papers. And so I should tell you the basis for a lot of the stuff I'm going to tell you about. It. It's Chaplin. It's a recent review paper. There are older ones that are good. And so I'm not picking on these people in particular, but they did a nice job. Chaplin and Miglio, it's in Annual Reviews of Astronomy and Astrophysics, 2013. But there are a bunch of good reviews out there, and they all basically say the same kind of stuff. But because I'm not an expert, you can probably, without too much difficulty, come up with some highly specific question that I won't be able to answer. Maybe you can think of that as a challenge. But also it means that I'm not going to really get into the details, and depending on how time passes, I may even finish this subject before the end of my allotted 90 minutes, in which case I have another topic in hand, which is magnetic fields, which I will either do now or perhaps in a tutorial or whatever. Okay, so it turns out, well, let me first say that, of course, if you're an expert in the field, what you're going to do is you're going to go away and take a model of a star which satisfies hydrostatic equilibrium and satisfies our understanding of how energy escapes from the interior and so on and so forth. And you're going to go calculate the normal modes of that star. And then you're going to try and match them up against the data. So you've got a set of spectral characteristics like this, and you're going to try and match them up against the data, and you're going to fiddle with parameters and find an optimum. So that's, in fact, what the experts do. But what I'm going to do here is try and give you a little bit of an understanding of the main information that emerges from this, the most straightforward of which has to do with the mean density of the star, which, if you know the mass, by the way, I should have mentioned, mass in some cases can, of course, be obtained from binary star systems, but often you don't have another way of getting mass. But in binary star systems, of course, you have information on this, which is independent. Microlensing usually doesn't give accurate numbers. Anyway, if you have mean density, you're already well along the way to characterizing the star adequately in terms of radius and mass, but it turns out there's another piece of information in this spectrum that can be used as well. So it turns out the most valuable information that comes from this spectrum is the spacing, and I'll explain where that comes from, and also the location of this set of lines. Are they here or are they over here at some other frequency? And that has to do with what's called the cutoff frequency, which is the frequency below which the waves are trapped in the inside of the star rather than propagating into the atmosphere. So let's first do the, before I do that, let me make a more straightforward observation. The kind of mode that we're talking about, the kind of oscillation that we're talking about, that I'm going to focus on is called P modes. And those are sound waves. So it's really very simple. They're sound waves. There are other modes. There are modes where the restoring force arises from static stability. And they're called G modes. I'm not going to talk about those. Obviously, there's information in those too. But it's not quite so straightforward to analyze those. So I'm going to concentrate on the P modes. And those can be just thought of as sound waves in a cavity. So if I have a box and I've got gas inside, then of course I can set up a resonance which has to do with the number of waves that fit in the box. And that's what's going to determine this, and indeed the spacing here is just related to different overtones. Now what's an overtone? An overtone refers to a wave which has multiple nodes, zeros, between the center of the star and the surface. So you can have two waves, one of which has, say, seven nodes between the center and the surface, and another one that has eight, or six, or whatever. And so we're going to come up with a simple approximation for that. So here's the way to think about this. I'm drawing it in one dimension. And I'm going to draw it between one side of the star and the other, although, of course, for a symmetric mode, it's got to be symmetric around the center. And that reminds me that I have to tell you something else, which has to do with the number of degrees of freedom in the modes. Now, of course, if you have spherical symmetry, which is called L equals zero in the language of spherical harmonics, you have modes where the dependence on latitude and longitude is absent. But you can have harmonics that are represented by quantum numbers, L equals 1, 2, 3, and so on. And you can also have quantum numbers that have to do with variation in longitude. So you actually have in this problem three quantum numbers. The one I've introduced already and I'm going to use here is n, which is in the radial direction. It's telling you how many waves there are in the radial direction. But of course, I can also have L, which is latitude, and M, which is longitude. And so you can have a very rich spectrum. Now, when we do the sun, when people do helioseismology, there's an immense richness of what they can see. So when you look at the sun, you can see a million modes because you've got these 3 degrees of freedom. You see them all, and you see the G modes, and it's an astonishing richness when you look at the sun. When you look at a distant star, you're going to be severely restricted because you're not using data that spatially resolves the surface of the star. And so a lot of these peaks will actually be L equals zero. But in practice, one also sees L equals 1 and maybe even sometimes L equals 2, and that just has to do with the fact that when you go to L equals 1 or L equals 2, you're not going to have a perfectly uniform change in the brightness of the star. So indeed, there is an additional complication there. But let me, for the moment, just talk about the radial direction. And so I'm representing here a wave, as if it were a wave on a string, but of course it's pressure fluctuations. And already when I draw this, I want to take into account the fact that, of course, the underlying formula here is velocity, which is sound speed, equals F lambda. And we're thinking about a fixed frequency because we're talking about normal modes that sit in the cavity. And therefore, of course, when the sound speed is higher, the wavelength is higher. And in a star, the sound speed is dictated by the ideal gas law. It's just the square root of kT upon mean molecular weight. So that means that the wavelength of the wave is going to be quite long, deepened in the star, and it's going to get shorter near the surface. So conceptually, it looks like this. And so what we want to do is to write down an approximate, and it's going to be approximate, statement of what's going on in this situation as we go from one overtone to the next. So what we can do, of course, from this equation is we can recognize that between here and here, there is an integer number of wavelengths. and so I can write an equation using the fact that 1 upon F equals lambda upon C. From that, I can say that if there are n waves between here and here, then n upon the frequency for that particular mode, n being because of the number of waves, is just the sum of these terms, lambda 1 upon C1 plus lambda 2 upon C2 plus lambda n upon Cn. And this, of course, means, you know, the first wave with the sound speed that goes with that wave plus the next wave with the sound speed that goes with that wave and so on all the way over to the other side. And, of course, in the limit of many waves, in this cavity. That, of course, can be approximated as the integral. Well, in this case, from minus r to r, I don't know why I put the minus here, it doesn't matter. But it's twice the integral from 0 to r, because it's going to be symmetric if it's in L equals 0 mode, twice the integral from 0 to r of dr, because the dr represents the lambdas over C of r. And of course, one can likewise write down the same equation for the next mode with n plus 1, because you're going to have n plus 1 waves. And that'll also be twice the integral from 0 to r of dr upon C of r. And then you can immediately see by cross-multiplying and putting the terms together that the frequency difference, which I'll write as delta nu, which is the frequency of the n plus 1 minus the frequency of the n, is just going to be 2 times the integral from 0 to r dr upon C of r to the minus 1. And this, of course, what you've got here is a reciprocal, well, basically related to the travel time, and so it's a reciprocal of the travel time. So this is the primary thing. Now, you have to be a little bit careful, because when you're actually looking at a spectrum, and I'll show you one in a little while, you have to decide whether these are both L equals 0. Typically, in the ones I'm going to show, it'll be L equals 0 and L equals 1. So they will be. So the delta mu here, in the example I will show, is actually this thing here. But let me explain what information this is giving you. Well, of course, C squared, adiabatic sound speed, gamma p upon rho. But of course, importantly, the speed of sound. Remember how pressure scales, gm squared upon r to the fourth. Density scales as m upon r cubed. And so, of course, this is just proportional to m upon r. And we've seen that already in several contexts during the school. And then, of course, when you put it in here, if you think about what that integral is behaving like, it's like r over the square root of m upon r. And so that's behaving like 1 over m upon r cubed to the 1/2. And that, of course, is mean density. So that's what the spectrum is primarily giving you. It's giving you the mean density of the star. And in fact, the way the numbers work out, for stars similar to the Sun, but actually it's sort of roughly true even as you go away from there, the answer is 135 m star over r star cubed to the 1/2. Units are microhertz. M star is in solar units, and r star is in solar units. Okay, so in the case of the Sun, it is in fact 135. At this point, I should mention, well, let me say two things. Obviously, when you actually do a real calculation, you have to know something about the not just typical temperatures, but the actual temperature profile, because the actual temperature profile comes in to the actual dependence of the speed of sound on radius. So that's point number one. But we think we understand that, because as I said, the basic physics of stars is well understood. So even though there's a little bit of wiggle room when you do a stellar evolution model, the profile, you might call it the polytropic index, if you will. Not that it's exactly a polytrope, but it's actually close to a polytrope. The polytropic index, which actually goes into this number, is sort of a universal thing. So as I go from one star to another, I have a universality, and that's why I can get something like this. But obviously, to actually get that number, you have to go into the actual physics of the temperature structure, pressure and density structure of the star. I should mention at this point that it's interesting you know, Tristan has been involved with the French group Gaume et al. In doing, in that case it's Fourier, spectroscopy of Jupiter. And actually, if I remember rightly, Tristan, it's something like 150. So it even sort of works for Jupiter, because M star upon R star cubed is the same for Jupiter as for the Sun, which just means that, you know, very the same. Now, of course, it's not the same polytrope, so you wouldn't expect it to work out perfectly, but it's remarkable how close you can get roughly the right answer, even in that case. Okay. Where did I put the eraser? Did I hide it? Yeah. So this is actually the most important thing. Oh, I should say, by the way, I mean, if you're paying attention, you will know immediately that this is a WKB approximation. That's the technical word for doing this. And obviously, there are corrections. And the corrections have to do with the way that the sound speed varies with radius and so forth, and second derivatives and so on. And of course, the experts use all that information, you know, to get the frequencies exactly right and spacing, which slightly changes with time. And they play games with adding and subtracting various frequencies in this spectrum, and they get more information. So they don't just rely on this. This was intended as a pedagogical exercise so that you could see how the information is obtained.
Okay. So yeah? According to this, the spacing is the same in all the modes?
So according to this simple picture, yes. In reality, no. And it also depends on the L. And remember, I told you that in the Kepler data, and you'll see an example in a little while, you do actually see other L's, and so there's additional information in comparing L equals 0 versus L equals 1 and so forth. L equals 1 to a first approximation can be thought of course, as just changing the number of waves in the cavity by half a wavelength. In fact, that is the correct way to think about L equals 1. And so, in fact, the L equals 1 peak is halfway between two L equals 0 peaks. To a good, not exactly, but to a good approximation. Okay, I will go now to something that I must confess, when I first read it, I had trouble believing. But since this is what people in astroseismology do, I will tell you what it is that they do, and you can judge it for yourself. They actually rely, in addition to this, which is very solid, on something to do with, as I said, the way in which this declines. So they look at the amplitudes as well as the frequencies. And the idea, the principle is physically very sound, but the way in which they do it is less intuitive, less obvious. The basic idea, of course, is that if you have a system where the density is changing rapidly, as it does towards the outside of the star, you have to consider the question of whether the sound waves can continue to propagate or whether they become evanescent, that is, have an exponential tail. And that, of course, is very similar to a problem you all know in basic physics, which is that if I have a system where the speed of sound changes abruptly as a function of radius, then this, of course, is a reflecting boundary. And so the question is, if I flatten that and send a wave in from this side, is it going to completely reflect, or is it going to partly go through? So that's the issue, and it affects the rate at which you get a cutoff in this frequency spectrum, because waves that propagate all the way into the photosphere lose energy. They become dissipative, whereas waves that are kept in the interior of the star, they still affect the surface because you've still got this evanescent movement of the gas up and down in the tail of a function which is the usual oscillatory wave function. So you still see it. These are evanescent in the atmosphere. That is, they're not propagating in the atmosphere. They're not propagating in the region that you see the signal. But but because they're kept in the cavity, they can they're more dissipated. They're higher Q. Okay, so now I want to talk about the idea of cutoff frequency. And I'm going to do a particularly simple model just so that you get the basic idea. This is not going to be enough to do a real calculation for stars, but it'll give you the basic idea. So I'm going to solve a particularly simple problem, which is the propagation of sound waves in a medium where the density is changing rapidly. And so I write down the equation of motion. Let me write it down and then explain what I've assumed in writing it down, because there are assumptions in writing it in this simple form. And I'm going to use, I can make it d by dz, but I'll keep it as a grand. Okay, so what have I done here? This is equation of motion. There's no dissipation. I've assumed linear theory. What does that mean? In the full equation of motion, what I should have over here is rho zero plus rho prime, where rho prime is the density perturbation due to the wave. Rho zero is the background density variation, which of course varies with height. Okay, so the density in the star is changing with height. P0 is the hydrostatic pressure, so it's going to be balanced off against these terms. P prime is the pressure fluctuation. I'm going to assume isothermal, and that means that I can write del of P prime as C squared del of rho prime. And of course, the other piece of information I have, again, linearizing it, is the equation of continuity. The equation of continuity says that the divergence of the background density times the velocity is the minus the derivative with respect to time of the temperature of the density fluctuation. Okay, so this is a very simple set of equations. You can see that if I take the divergence of this equation, I get del dot of rho zero v. And I can take the d by dt out. The other thing I've left out, of course, is v dot del v, because it's infinitesimal waves. And so I can take the divergence of this. That will give me a del squared of rho prime. And I can take d by dt of this, and that will give me the second derivative with respect to time of rho prime. And so when you do all that, you will get minus d2 rho prime by dt squared, which I can write as omega squared rho prime, omega being the frequency of the wave that I'm interested in. And that'll be minus c squared. If I assume that the wave is propagating vertically, so I don't have variation in the other direction, so I'm going to write this as minus c squared d2 rho prime by dz squared. And the other term is g d rho prime by dz. And so that's our differential equation. And if I divide through by omega squared and put everything on one side, this is a simple eigenvalue problem. I've got omega squared upon c squared. Let's do this. We'll have rho prime be proportional to e to the lambda z. And if we do that, what we get is omega squared upon c squared plus lambda squared plus lambda upon h equals 0, where h, of course, is c squared upon g. This is a definition of the scale height. So that's how h entered, because I had a g here, I divide by c squared. I get a 1 upon h. And then, of course, I can just solve this. Lambda is 1 half of minus 1 upon h plus minus the square root 1 upon h squared minus 4 omega squared upon c squared. And so you can see that there will be an oscillatory solution, provided, of course, the frequency is large enough. If I make the frequency larger than C upon 2H, then I will get an oscillatory wave. And if omega is less than C upon 2H, then lambda is real. And so that'll be an evanescent wave. Of course, it can propagate somewhere else, but in the particular region where H is small enough, that's what you will get. Now, this is clearly not an adequate description because it's not an isothermal star. But this is the easy way of understanding why waves might not propagate in a region where the density is varying rapidly enough. And so the basic idea is that this will give you a sense, since H, of course, is like C squared upon G, this cutoff frequency, so this is called the cutoff frequency, which obviously depends on where you evaluate it, but the cutoff frequency is C upon 2H. And of course, since H goes like C squared upon G, this is behaving like G upon C, and that's behaving like the effective temperature, if this is evaluated in the atmosphere, effective temperature to the minus 1/2 times G. Okay, so the claim is that if I can identify a characteristic of this spectrum that is showing that the waves at that frequency are not propagating, since I already know the effective temperature, this will give me little g. So that's the argument. The argument is that this procedure will give you little g, which in addition to the thing I already told you, which is you'll get the mean density, you've got all the information that you need to get radius and mass. So from little g and from mean density, I can, of course, derive mass and radius. That's the idea. As I said, I actually find this, I'm surprised they rely so much on that, but they do. All right, good. So let me show you some examples of what the data look like. And I'm probably good enough now to even be able to do this stuff myself. Except it's always hard to... and where's the screen? How about that? I'm the first person to do it almost. I think. This is the projector on, though. Ah! I thought it was. It takes a while. What have I done wrong? Yeah, it's just a bit slow, I guess. All right. So this is from the review paper that I mentioned. So this is an example of Kepler data. So this just looks like what I got on the blackboard. This thing here is what I said you can get from the calculation I did on the board. These peaks. Now, you know, when you do this kind of thing, obviously you have to develop some experience so that you can look at the spectrum and identify what these modes are. As to how many nodes there actually are, That's kind of tricky. But fortunately, because of the way you analyze the data, you don't actually need to know that. But you need to recognize that this is indeed an L equals 0. That's also an L equals 0. That's an L equals 1. And there's other structure here. So this, so you actually, in this beautiful data set, this particular star, you can even see the L equals 2. Now, of course, if you were to have the kind of data they have on the sun, this would be a real forest. But and you can see that there are other things labeled here which have to do with subtle differences with different L values. But this is the kind of data. And so here you see it sitting on the background of the photometry, this forest of resonances. And up here, there's a diagram which I'm not going to try and talk you through, but it's the fact that these data are so good that you can even see the rotational splitting. Now, once you've got rotation, you can split the different M values, and so that's what's happening here. And notice the scale here, 2,262 microhertz and so forth. So you're seeing these very small splittings. I notice also they even in these data see the L equals 3. With respect to the question of how it varies from star to star, this is a very good example for a sequence of stars, relatively short cadence data, different stars with of different mean density, and so you can see how the spectrum marches along. It's hard to see that one, but there it is, to progressively lower frequency as you go to bigger stars. Remember, this is the squeaky star, this is the base tone. And in terms of the kind of data, this is Kepler, this is Corot. You'll notice Corot, a lot of the data are giant stars. Kepler, there's a lot of stars as part of the main sequence. So it's actually quite a spectacular data set. And I put this in to remind you of the kind of accuracy that they're claiming that come from these Kepler stars with planets, the kind of accuracy. And of course, when Dave Charbonneau showed radius versus mass and emphasized, as he likes to emphasize, those ones that don't have atmospheres, so they're sitting on a nice radius versus mass curve that looks like the Earth. He's relying, of course, on these spectacular accuracies for the star. So you can see it here, you know, 2%, 2%, typically 2% masses. Sometimes a somewhat bigger error bar. You can get the, as you can imagine, because this comes in cubed, typically you're going to have error bars for the mass that are a factor of 2 or 3 bigger when you work it through than for the radii. So the radii, you can get to 2% mass, more like 5 or 6%. And so I put this one into, yes?
So the principle of the cutoff frequency is basically looking for the largest frequency of, let's say, L equals 0 that you can see in the spectrum.
So, this is the part that I'm actually a little unhappy about, because I don't, what they say in the literature, I'll tell you what they say, and you can judge it for yourself. So what they do is, they look at something like this, and they say the cutoff frequency scales with the biggest peak. Now the cutoff frequency is over here, but it scales with that, and so the whole spectrum moves back and forth. To me, that's not entirely obvious, but I'm telling you what they do. And so there's a literature. And I must say that, you know, I'm not an expert, but in the literature they acknowledge that this is an issue. Is this really true? And so there are, in fact, papers where they debate, can you really get the cutoff frequency by taking the peak and using that as a scale, not the number that goes with this, but using it as a scale for the cutoff frequency. But that's what they do. Of course, they also, model the hell out of the data, you know, and try and fit everything with you know, huge modeling. Was, yeah?
Is it true why the L equal 1 amplitude is louder than the L equal 0?
So you've won the prize for asking a question that I don't know the answer to. Good for you. I have no idea. It's not at all intuitive. Yes, I wondered that too. And so I carefully avoided saying it. I don't know. Does somebody else know?
I think I kind of know. Because theoretically, if they are both excited stochastically by convection, then both modes should share the same energy as the convection eddy.
Yeah, I knew that, but I'm not sure how that gets me to the answer.
But if both share the same energy, then L equals to one mode would have one half of the star expanding, the other half shrinking. So if you are saying that the expanding or shrinking parts more, okay, L equals to one mode would be exactly canceled if you see the this half and the expanding half and shrinking half exactly, but if you are a little bit misaligned.
Yeah, this is not spatially resolved data.
No, so but I mean, if you see it's a point.
Well, all right. you can try and convince me later. It's as sure as hell it's not obvious to me.
Fluctuation is a sum over Legendre polynomials.
Sorry?
There are PLM, the Legendre polynomials.
Yes?
The whole perturbation is assumed linear, and linear
correct
perturbation of Legendre polynomials. How they share their fluctuation, it depends.
Oh, I agree completely. I mean, I've actually thought about that aspect of the problem because I mean, you know, Tristan worries about this too. How the hell does this work in Jupiter? I mean, why would some modes get excited and others? This turns out to be a major issue for potentially for understanding Juno data because these modes may be excited to a level where they show up in the gravity data. Okay, this is photometric. But they could, in principle, show up in the gravity data because when a planet's doing this, it changes the gravity field. But the whole business of excitation and how the excitation is distributed among the frequencies and so forth, there is, of course, a standard story for that, for the Sun, which was pioneered by Peter Goldreich and people who work with him, Goldreich and Keeling, and other people have worked on this as well. Yeah.
What about the width of the spectral lines?
So the width of the spectral lines, as I understand it, is, in many cases, non-linear. That is to say, the modes are sharing energy. Okay, so you've got stochastic excitation. In other words, it's not intrinsic. Intrinsic is a possibility. If you had some, you know, if you had viscosity, real viscosity, you could imagine that that would determine the peak. But actually, the viscosities are so low that what's really happening is that the wave builds up to some amplitude and then it feeds energy into other modes and basically it goes all over. And so you've got stochastic excitation and stochastic damping, meaning that all of this is happening in a convective medium and so energy is being shared back and forth in a quasi-equilibrium fashion. You'll notice I haven't actually answered the question. But what I said is sort of true, but I mean, you know, I can't give you a number. By the way, this is of course, when in this kind of data, you also have to worry about the cadence. That is, how long you collected the data and the quality of the data. And so I actually don't know for these data what people say about that particular question, whether it has to do with the quality of the data and how long they've collected it versus whether they've actually resolved. I suspect they've resolved it, but as to actually interpreting it, I don't know. Okay. Are there any other questions?
Just one question.
Yeah.
How many data points do they have?
Data. Now, what do you mean by data points? Like, I mean, it's just collecting the
set of data has like 1,000 points or
Oh, I think it's a lot more than that. But I'm sorry, I can't quote you a number offhand.
For less than seven, for long cable data, yeah, have 60 or 77 points. But then some of these targets, especially for astrophysicology, the brighter ones, then they have short cable data.
Yes.
And then these quarter of a million data points and so on.
Yeah. Yeah, I've shown you both short and long cadence. I wanted to finish with a comment about something that happens to be in this table, which is this number. And of course, this is so this is tricky. I mean, unlike the things I've been telling you about, you can't actually go to a star and ask it, how old are you? You have to... Why are you laughing?
It's rude. Not allowed to ask for it.
But of course, you can do models, and the theoretical framework for understanding stars on the main sequence is very well developed. And in the case of solar mass stars, which evolve substantially, our sun has evolved quite a bit. The luminosity has changed a fair bit over time, and so on. It doesn't work so well with M dwarfs, of course. And so, you know, a lot of the data that Dave Charbonneau wants to collect, it's harder. But in principle, if you had enough understanding of your models, and you had radius and mass, so you're going to throw everything into your model. You've got all your astroseismological data, you've got the usual other stuff, metallicity, and so on and so forth. Then you can get age. And that is really exciting, in my opinion, because if we can get to the point where we can actually look at planetary systems as a function of age, that would be very exciting. Now, it's not clear to me that that's realistic, but that would be really exciting. In this particular case, it's actually determined rather well. So, so clearly, astroseismology is going to be an important part of the future of exoplanets, because we don't really... So I was asking after the talk that we heard about Hipparchus and Gaia, to what extent is the very precise astrometric data and other data that they collect going to replace astroseismology? And the answer I got is no, it's complementary. So astroseismology is going to continue to be a very important part of understanding exoplanets. That's all I plan to say. I'm happy to deal with questions, and in the time after that, I will talk about magnetic fields.
So you showed that spherical symmetric L equals zero modes, they have harmonics. They're at fixed intervals. But this doesn't explain why higher L should have fixed intervals, and my intuition is that they shouldn't.
Well, actually, they sort of do, and the main thing there is that at low L and at high N, it's still basically a wave that is in the radial direction. The oscillations are in the radial direction. Yes, you're right, there's a correction. I haven't written, you know, if you go to this review paper, they will tell you about the corrections that depend, of course, on L times L plus 1. So there are corrections of that sort. And I also chose not to talk about what people do in helioseismology, where they talk about ray paths, because, of course, what happens to the waves if the surface is like this is that the waves are doing this. But that's less important for understanding the astroseismology data, because it's not spatially resolved. So, yes, you're right. There is information there, and it does actually figure as part of the analysis of the data. They compare... The frequencies they have at L equals 0 with L equals 1 and L equals 2, especially L equals 2. So they compare L equals 0 with L equals 2, and that turns out that difference gives you additional information that is telling you about how the sound speed varies with radius. Yeah, Sivan.
Just to get a feeling, how does these accuracies compare to the accuracies without astroseismology?
So you're asking what are the numbers, the corresponding numbers that you would have in this table, if you did not have astroseismology? 10%. So, and that's big, okay? So here we're talking 2%. That's actually a complicated question to answer because it sort of has to do with confidence level. In other words, you know, it's hard to actually give error bars because in the end, it depends to some extent on how confident you are in stellar evolution models. And the people who do it are very confident. But so they would probably say, oh, I can do 5%. But people who are more sober and cynical say 10%. Adam?
I'm curious to what extent the amplitudes of the modes vary on kind of longer time scales. I mean, you can imagine them varying just due to the stochastic forcing, but I wonder if there might also be information in there on variability inherent in the convection zone. That's
an interesting question. I don't know the answer. Of course, to do that, what you'd have to do is collect this data, you know, for a chunk of time and then do it again.
Yeah, like Kepler's got several years of data on short frequency, I mean, a short cadence, so, you know, I mean,
do you have something in mind for what would produce longer? I mean, of course, there's all the business of, well, there are variations on rotation timescales, perhaps. But what would you think of for a longer timescale than rotation?
I don't have anything specific in mind, but I'm just thinking that most fluid systems, like in the Earth's climate and Jupiter and, you know, probably other systems, hot Jupiters and so on, brown dwarfs have long timescale variability. Know that you have certain short time scales that might be forcing the system or something, in this case maybe this convection, but there'll be all sorts of modes that are just inherent in the diameter.
Yeah, I don't know. What occurs to me is that at the boundary between, I mean, in the Sun-like star, of course, you've got convection and then radiation, and there is convective overshoot, and so there are things that could be longer time scale at that boundary. Maybe. I don't know. Yeah, Tucson.
My understanding, of course, for these Kepler stars, we have no idea, but for the Sun, we have excellent data, and you can trace, and you can calculate the lifetime of the modes.
Yeah.
And this is of the order of days to months or something like that. So you really see the, if you look really hard at the data.
So there you're seeing the fluctuation. It's not that it's actually dying, but it's fluctuating as energy is put in and taken out of the mode.
That's
the time scale you're talking
exactly,
about. Yeah.
Exactly. So it's not the resonance that lasts for a long, long time. It's a stochastic excitation.
Yeah. Yeah.
If a Jupiter mass object impacted the solar mass star, would you be able to see that with the astroseismometer?
You might see it other ways as well, yeah. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So the answer is yes.
they tried with Shoemaker-Levy.
Yes. Yeah. Although that was mostly changing the albedo. But yes. Well, I mean, of course, that is photometry. But I mean, you know, it's a different physical. I understand what Tristan's getting at. Actually, I got into that game as well. So the question was, okay, we've got Shoemaker-Levy. It's going to hit Jupiter. This was back whenever it was, 1990, thereabouts. And so people got all interested in the idea that this might make Jupiter get excited. And I did my calculation and decided it was a waste of time. And Hugh Van Horn did his calculation and published it in APJ. There were some very interesting things observed, there are good reasons why it's actually hard in a planet with very low density envelope like that to excite the normal modes. You really have to get down somewhat deeper. Somewhat deeper might only be hundreds of bars, but the objects that came in, the fragments of the comet that came in, punched only down to, I don't remember the numbers, but not deep enough to get really good coupling. Yeah. Speak up, I can't hear you.
Yes, okay. So, So now you have this star. You have the star itself. You know its modes. Are there examples for which it was measured that, for example, close by companion could excite some modes in the star itself? So I'm thinking about close binary companions, for example.
Do you know?
The heartbeat stars.
Yes.
Called,
yes. So the answer is yes. And that actually raises another interesting point, which is that in tidal problems, there's the very interesting question of whether you can excite normal modes by tides. And I've actually thought about that quite a bit. Depends on what kind of mode. I've only told you about one particular set of modes, the P modes, but there can be other modes. And that's of interest for Jupiter, you know, whether the bulge raised by Io might be close to some resonance. There are all sorts of modes that I haven't told you about. There are inertial oscillations, there may be interfacial waves. You know, Tristan and his models of Jupiter likes to put in an interface that will actually support gravity waves, you know. So there's all sorts of stuff in addition to the obvious thing. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so you're right, there are special cases where you can get accuracy as good as astroseismology in some other way, yeah.
Yeah.
Or better, yeah.
And, but for astroseismology, okay, Pankaj said that, for instance, important is also to determine the previous spacing, because we want, according to certain theory, an approximation red of the solution there. P modes, as far as I remember, they are equally spaced in period, and the other P modes are equally spaced in period. So, and as the star evolves, of course, it changes the composition, and it changes the change in composition, changes also the
Yeah, yeah. Right. So, looking at how the spectrum changes, as the but in the end, it would seem to me you have to rely to some extent on the standard stellar structure theories about what happens as you burn hydrogen into helium and so forth. Yes. Yeah. Of course, I haven't talked about rotation, but obviously getting good rotation data would be great as well. All right. Last comment, question.
As a bystander, I understand that astroseismology is a daughter of helioseismology. Sun is a wonderful star. As much as I remember talking with some solar physicists, they get thousands of peaks.
Oh, in fact, I think it's more like a million.
Yeah. And from this, by consistency, they get much more than average density.
Oh, they get all sorts of stuff.
So this is
sure,
they
and they can. They even get the rotation state. They get the differential rotation and all sorts of stuff.
Okay.
And the effect of magnetic fields,
and that's very
which is elite. Yes. I didn't want to talk about magnetic fields in this context, but indeed that's...
So the sun goes through several interesting processes which affect the structure of the cell. Mainly flares, CME, coronal mass ejections, and some amazing story which people know, they can be called some bump bombs.
Yeah.
Which change the structure. And this can affect, interestingly, in time scale, the power spectrum that is structured. So now magnetic field.
All right, there's only 20 minutes, so we might come back to this later in the tutorial, but there are other things that could also be done in the tutorial. Let's see what happens. But let me just give you a little bit of a taste about planetary magnetic fields. Now, magnetic fields come into the exoplanet game in many different ways. But from the point of view of understanding the planet itself, you would like to know whether it has a magnetic field, because that's telling you something about the interior of the planet. Same argument we would use in our own solar system. But in addition, people who worry about atmospheric escape are concerned about the possibility that the magnetic field can affect the escape of material from the atmosphere. In our own solar system, rightly or wrongly, it's not clear who's right on the story, the presence of a magnetic field in the early history of Mars, which is well documented through the paleomagnetism of the rocks, the crust, as seen by orbiters, but also actually confirmed to some extent by looking at meteorites, SNCC meteorites, Mars meteorites. The presence of a magnetic field in the early history of Mars has been used by some people as an argument for keeping the atmosphere around, and then when the magnetic field died, as it must have, so that all that's left is the magnetism in the rocks rather than the field generated in the core at that point, some of the atmosphere was lost. It's not clear that's true, but it is a relevant issue to think about. So it's of great interest to understand whether a planet has a magnetic field. It has a potential relevance for habitability. Yeah?
Do you have, again, any review articles that would be
good? Speak up.
Could you cite any review articles which would be good for this subject?
On the general subject of planetary magnetic fields, I have some review papers, yes. There's one in Space Science Reviews about a decade ago, and there's a much longer one I wrote in 1983. And there will also be papers on the data by people like Chris Russell, Jack Canoning, and others. A brief comment before I say something more about whether a planet will have a magnetic field on observability. If you go on the web and try and find out about what people say concerning magnetic fields of exoplanets, what they will typically tell you about is the bow shock and its consequences for transit observations and other aspects of the environment adjacent to the planet. And there, of course, the idea is that if I have a planet, has a magnetic field, it produces a standoff of the plasma flowing by, and that might be observable. And indeed, there are claims in the literature of seeing that effect. So that's a way of inferring the presence of a magnetic field. In principle, you could also, if the field's really large, see it in Zeeman, although that's not practical for planets, but that's how it's done for stars. You may be able to see it in polarimetry, because if you have radiation, electromagnetic radiation coming from an object where there's a magnetic field, there may be a preferred sense of polarization for that energy, so you would do polarimetry. The particular technique that I'm interested in and involved in, but it hasn't paid off yet, except for brown dwarfs, is looking at the decametric radiation. So in our own solar system, just to remind you of a bit of history, the way we knew that Jupiter has a magnetic field is by looking at the radio emissions from Jupiter, and in fact, Jupiter is the largest radio source in the night sky. It's a hugely powerful source. It happens to be a synchrotron, but it also emits decametrically, that is, the wavelengths at tens of meters, frequencies like 20 megahertz. And those frequencies can be interpreted in terms of magnetic field strength, and of course, the period of rotation of Jupiter is known to exquisite accuracy, 1 part in 10 to the 6, by the period of the radio bursts from Jupiter. So that's how we know that Jupiter rotates, or at least the magnetic field rotates. Interesting question as to exactly what that means for the planet. But we think that's the rotation rate of the deep interior, 9 hours, 55 minutes, 27.2 seconds, or whatever. So you get rotation information, and if you see the decametric emission from the planet, then that's very exciting. Interestingly, the cutoff, because of the Earth's ionosphere, is at about 1 Gauss. And that means we, on Earth, do not see our own radio emission. So the radio emission that the Earth produces, which is impressive if you're out in space, is actually not observable from the Earth's surface, because the relevant frequencies are cut off by the intervening ionosphere. That's also why we did not know that Saturn had a magnetic field until we put a spacecraft up in Earth orbit, IMP-6. This is before Voyager and Pioneer. So we knew that Saturn had a magnetic field before we sent a spacecraft there. Uranus and Neptune, too weak again, by virtue of being further out and just being smaller sources. But if you think that you can have magnetic fields substantially in excess of a Gauss, and especially if you're looking at a giant planet, there's a reasonable likelihood that we can detect the decametric radiation. And Greg Hallinan at Caltech has, with a student, I'm co-author also, paper in press or maybe published, we have results for brown dwarfs. We don't have results yet for exoplanets. And we have seen kilogauss fields on brown dwarfs by this method. So in 10 minutes, and maybe I will return to this later depending on what else we do, let me just give you a very brief statement about what the issue is with magnetic fields of planets. The basic idea, of course, is that you have a dynamo. And the way a dynamo works is by fluid motions in an electrical conductor. And if the motions are sufficiently vigorous, then you can stretch the magnetic field lines and replace the field that would otherwise diffuse away because of the finite electrical conductivity of the medium. Remember that if I have a conductor and I have a current in that conductor, then the field will decay, that's called a free induction time, because whenever you have an electrical current in a finite conductivity, you get ohmic dissipation, so the energy in the field goes into heat, and you have to replenish the field, or equivalently the current, through Ampere's law, through doing work. And so you have the convective motions doing work, which then shows up as a magnetic field. And far and away, the best way to do this is thermal or compositional convection. And the reason why convection is favored is because when you convect heat, you have radial motions, and radial motions turn out to be essential for a dynamo. It's not enough to do this, you have to do this as well. And the field that results from this has two aspects, a toroidal field and a poloidal field, which is what we see. So you want to use convection, and the basic criterion is that if you have a convective velocity V and some length scale which may be of order the size of the planet or the region where the connectivity is high enough, then you want VL upon lambda to be greater than of order some critical number like 10. This thing is called the magnetic Reynolds number. And lambda has units of diffusivity. So for example, in SI units, lambda is 1 upon mu naught sigma. Just to prove I can occasionally use SI units. But in this way of writing it, sigma is in Siemens per meter. Mu naught, of course, is 4 pi by 10 to the minus 7, so it's about 10 to the minus 6. Typical metals are 10 to the plus 6 Siemens per meter. Your blood is about 1. Enough so that you can get electrocuted, but much less than a metal. So often this is something like 1 meter squared per second or 10 to the 4 centimeter squared per second. Notice these are high diffusivities compared to diffusion of heat in the sense of a conducting medium. Conducting medium will typically be 10 to the minus 2 in these units. So diffusion of magnetic field is fast, and that's crucial to the argument of a dynamo. That's why when you see a field, and it's a large global field, it cannot be a primordial field. The sun can have a primordial field, in principle. Probably doesn't, but in principle, the sun could have a primordial field. So it's so big, and so the diffusion time can be longer than the age of the solar system, or at least comparable. But objects like Jupiter, even, the diffusion time is a lot less than the age of the solar system. So for example, if I have motions like those that Tristan was telling us about deep in Jupiter, which, one centimeter per second, say, and this might be 10 to the 8 or 10 to the 9 centimeters per second, and this might be 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5, something like that, then you can see that it's easily satisfied. Now, here's the most important message that I want to get across. In giant planets, and even in ice giants, like Uranus and Neptune, it is usually the case, in fact, nearly always the case, that satisfying the criterion for a dynamo is readily accomplished. It is usually the case, with the caveats that Tristan talked about, that you have convection. If you have a compositional gradient, you're in trouble deep down. But in some substantial part of the planet, you're likely to have sufficient conductivity that you can satisfy this criterion and have a dynamo. And of course, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune all have dynamos. And the crucial thing is not just that I'm satisfying this, but that you are satisfying the criterion for any convection. And that turns out to be the central issue, I believe, for terrestrial planets. Because the interesting thing about terrestrial planets, including Earth, is that it's a close call as to whether it works. Yes, the Earth does it. Yes, Mercury does it. Venus does not do it. Mars does not do it now. The Moon used to do it. Ganymede does it. Titan does not do it. You can see that it's a toss-up in some sense. And the reason for that is not so much what the electrical conductivity is, but whether you have convection at all. And in terrestrial planets, it's a close call, especially if you're relying on thermal convection. And the reason is that for the heat flows typical of terrestrial planets, you can carry that heat by conduction. And then you don't get convection at all, and V is zero. So yes, there's heat coming out, but it's carried by conduction. And that turns out to be an issue for the Earth. If you tried to run Earth dynamo for an extended period of time just using cooling, in all likelihood, Earth's dynamo would turn off. People often ask about rotation. It is indeed the case that the form of the convective motions that you get in a rotating planet are particularly, I shouldn't say particularly, but they are suitable for running a dynamo. This, by the way, is a necessary condition for a dynamo. It's not a sufficient condition. That is, I can come up with fluid motions that do not run a dynamo, even though they have a large magnetic Reynolds number. So this is actually a tricky issue. And in the history of dynamo theory, this was a hang-up for decades because people had difficulty understanding what kind of motion would actually do the job. And that finally got solved independently by one person in one group. The person who solved the problem, so to speak, was Gene Parker. You've heard about Gene Parker already at this school, very famous scientist, University of Chicago, who worked on solar wind, his theory of the solar wind. But he also worked on this issue. And of course, he wanted to understand how the sun generated its magnetic field, but in so doing, he also built the basic ideas for dynamos in general. And his idea was that you have a combination of differential rotation, not rigid body rotation, but the fact that the fluid is not rotating uniformly, plus what he called cyclonicity, but actually in the modern language we would call it helicity, that is a mean value for V dot del cross V. Okay, so if I trace out a spiral, that's a flow that has a net sense of flow in this direction, but it also has, by the right-hand rule, a vorticity. So V dot del cross V averaged is called helicity. It's a scalar number, and that's also called the alpha effect. The other one, differential rotation, is called the omega effect. So Parker invented those terms. The other group that did something very interesting was Steenbeck, Krauss, and Rader in what was then East Germany, and they did some neat experiments. They actually pumped liquid sodium through a spiral tube and saw an induction effect. You know, you look at the equations, I won't write them down, but you look at the equations, you'll find that that's a good way to induce magnetic field. This is obviously not a direct analog to what's happening in a planet because you're forcing the fluid to follow a particular path. But Steenbeck, Krauss, and Radler, working in Potsdam mainly, did some experiments and developed the theory. And the theory is called mean field. And actually, in the end, if you look at it, it's pretty much what Gene Parker was doing as well, except Parker did it in a more phenomenological way. The East German group developed it in a much more systematic, mathematical way. And it's called mean field theory. And again, that gives you the alpha effect. And so by the late 50s and early 60s, people knew how dynamos worked. But to come back to the question of rotation, this kind of motion is something that you can imagine naturally might arise in a rotating fluid because of the Coriolis effect. Question of how much rotation you need is still not fully answered. There's some suspicion that if you rotate really fast, that can actually inhibit a dynamo, because it's well known from classic work, go look at Chandrasekhar's monograph, that very rapid rotation actually inhibits convection. But anyway, so people, and I've done this myself, have often said that in addition you need Rossby number less than 1. Remember the Rossby number, 2 omega L. V over 2 omega L. So you want it to be small enough so that the Coriolis force matters. I think I should stop there, and we may come back to this in the tutorial. It depends. Let's see. Raim's not here right now, right? Right. Is he coming back? Did he say? Okay. And he probably has something, but we also have some other topics to talk about. So we will have no shortage of things. But right now is time for a break. Any quick questions on this? I mean, obviously, I've only given you a sort of an overview, so it may not be. Yeah?
So you said that the only evidence of magnetic fields is a bow shock.
People, I guess some people think they might have seen, oh, so the other thing they see is H-alpha, and people talk about aurora. So it's not just about, so it's not just the visual appearance of how the transit is asymmetric. There's perhaps other evidence as well. So it's not clear to me how you interpret that kind of data, but there are claims of that sort.
My point is that you don't need a Boshoff. You don't need a magnetic field to create a Boshoff.
You're completely right. You're completely right. Yes, but you can get a bigger one. I was telling you that to tell you what people say in the literature. Who knows what the correct interpretation is? But that's a good comment.
So, exactly the way that you say the bathymetric radiation from Jupiter, the most intense emission from our planet is AKR, auroral.
Yes, fair enough.
This is done on aurora.
Yes.
Like every magnetic field on every planet. And this is not synchrotron radiation.
That's right.
This is a so-called collective phenomenon.
Yes, and that's what happens in decametric. Yes, so it's a collective motion of the electrons.
And maybe in the future, this will be one of the signs that magnetic field exists.
Yes. Yes, you've raised an important point. The collective motion is, so it's actually, in terms of the basic physics, it's related to how lasers work and how masers work and so forth. So that's an important part of why the radiation is as strong as it is. But there are people trying to do this or thinking ahead about how to do it in space. The person I know who does this is Greg Hallinan at Caltech, but there are people in Europe and elsewhere in the U.S. And you use array data to get positions. So we have been using LOFAR, which is a radio astronomical array, Germany, the Netherlands, that area. And of course, we also use Owens Valley, which is run by Caltech. Let's have a break now until 4 o'clock, and we have Giovanna.